Anthony Venn-Brown, thanks for agreeing to do the interview. Now, you've lived a full life. You've been a writer, you've been gay, you've been in the closet, you came out to the Assemblies of God Church, you were a church leader, you had a family, now you're a personal motivator. Tell us a bit about your story. How did it all start?
Well, I guess the place to start would be back when I started to awaken, my sexual desire started to awaken, and that was, you know, in the 60s, and when I discovered that I was attracted to guys and not girls. Of course, at that time, it was a criminal offence for two men to have sex together. Our mental health professionals tried to treat them through aversion therapy and electric shock treatment, sometimes lobotomies. So when I discovered what that meant, well, I realised, well, this is the person I don't want to be. I don't want to be a criminal, certainly not sick mentally. And so that launched me on a path to do everything I could to try and change my natural sexual orientation.
And how did you do that?
Well, I tried everything. The first thing that I did, of course, was I believed that God would be the answer. So what I did was I became a Christian, that God could do miracles, and so I started praying, and then I went to Bible college in New Zealand, and then when I came back from that, I'd already gone through exorcisms there to try and cast the demons of homosexuality out of me. That didn't work, so then I went into a ex-gay program for about 7 months here in Sydney, which was Australia's first.
Were they the conversion programs?
Yes, conversion.
They tried program. To turn you straight, really.
Tried to turn me into a heterosexual by doing all sorts of things, by dressing a certain way, you know, by acting a certain way, doing manly things, you know, trying to make a man out of me. But of course, you can't change the orientation on the inside. You're able to change things on the outside, but the inside stays the same.
So was your main reason for joining Christianity, joining religion, was it as an escape from your sexuality?
Not an escape, but I was driven to that to find an answer for my sexual orientation in Christianity.
And what was that answer you were looking for?
I was asking for a miracle.
And was that really to become straight, heterosexual?
Yes, yes.
So were there feelings of guilt at the time?
Guilt, shame, fear, all those things, William, all those things were going on. And, you know, there is that huge pressure within society at that time, which still exists to a little bit today, to conform to society, you know, that every man, you know, you get married and you have children, that's what you do. And so this is what a good person does. This is what everybody expects. And so that pressure was very strong.
And you conformed, didn't you?
I did. That was after I went through the ex-gay program, then I got married believing that I had enough control over my same-sex attraction.
And did your wife, did she have any idea of your past, your feelings?
I did tell her. Just before we got engaged, I told her that, you know, that I had been a homosexual, but that, you know, that I had now overcome that, and this was a part of God's miracle now, that I actually wanted to get married. But looking back, it's actually only been recently, William, that I think I've come to the realization that I wasn't really in love with my wife. I was in love with the idea of being married, of being a husband, of being a father.
So you wanted to be quote-unquote normal.
I so wanted to be normal. Who wants to stand out and be ridiculed and be... And, of course, anything attached with homosexuality at that time, there was never anything positive about it. It was always negative. They were predators, they were child abusers, they were perverted, you know. The list goes on. So there was never any sense of pride or empowerment attached to being gay.
Now, you were with the Assemblies of God Church. Now, can you tell us a bit about how that church, what it's about, and how Pentecostal churches, of which it is one, they differ from, say, maybe Roman Catholic or the Church of England?
Oh, okay. Well, the Pentecostal church is a relatively new phenomena. It is a Protestant church, and the roots go back to the early 1900s in the US. The thing that differentiates it, of course, it's a Bible-believing church, would be the same as Baptist and other Protestant denominations, but the thing that differentiates it, I guess, is their belief in the supernatural, in miracles, in healing, and speaking in tongues, and also the other thing is the vibrancy of the worship, you know, that when Pentecostals worship, they really get into it, so there's clapping and singing and dancing, and, you know, it's more like a celebration than a funeral service.
Would you say it's one of those, what they call a happy clappy church?
Happy clappy church, that's what some people call them, yeah, happy
Brilliant.
Clappy church, yeah.
So you were married, was your wife within the church as well?
We're all in the church, all very, very committed Christians.
And had you confided to anybody in the church, or at this time did you honestly believe you were straight?
No, there have been times when, you know, like, for example, as a Bible college, I told the Bible college principal that's when I went off for the exorcisms. Then when I came back, of course, and I was having trouble, and I told my pastor that's when I went into the Live-In Escape program. So there were times when I shared openly with people, but every time that I did, that wasn't really, really handled appropriately. So, because people are ignorant, you know.
Of course.
At that time, and still today within many churches, no one has done any research.
What were you preaching yourself?
I was preaching a very positive message. I was preaching a life message, you know, of change and that God had a good life for us, and, you know, there's peace in Jesus Christ. And, you know, it was never a condemning message. It was always a very positive message.
So if a young gay Christian at the time was struggling with his sexuality and he came to you for advice back then, what would you have said?
What I would have said was what was being said to me, which was, you need to pray harder, you know, you need to try harder, God's bigger than this thing, God and you can beat it together, you know, it's temptation, you can overcome it. So, you know, I had all the things that I was told that were there in the Bible. Of course, they weren't working for me, but I was really, really hoping that one day I would be completely free, and that the people that I was sharing this with would be able to maybe have even more success than I was having.
So though you wanted to be straight yourself, and perhaps to an extent believed you were, for other people, did you believe homosexuality was wrong?
Oh yes, yeah. My total belief system at that time was based upon the Bible. I had not read any scientific research on it. I didn't know that there was such a thing as a gay Christian. Those people, you know, as far as I knew, there was that. Yeah, actually, when I left the ministry, William, that was the thing. When I left the ministry, I actually saw that I only had two choices. One was to be heterosexual and go to heaven, or to be homosexual and go to hell. So, you know, when I finally, after 22 years of trying everything to change my sexual orientation, had to face the fact that nothing had actually changed, I was still gay, that meant that I was turning my back on God and my relationship with God, and turning my back on the church, because I couldn't put those two things together.
I mean, you were a church leader, weren't you, at the time? You were preaching around the world.
Preaching around the world in all the mega churches here in Australia. You know, I used to preach sometimes to 5,000 people in a time in congregation. And, my name was pretty well a household name, you know, in certain circles, because I was so well known.
Were you happy at the time?
I was happy that I was serving God. I was happy that my life was making a difference to the lives of others. I was happy about all that. So that was all there, but internally, you know, like behind the scenes, I was fighting this very lonely, tormented battle constantly, doing everything possible to try and overcome any thought or temptation regarding